you so much for coming to the opening of our Me exhibition. We are thrilled to be seeing the self-portraits and the self-expression of all of these artists, and thrilled that you all have come out to witness the beginning of this exhibition.
So thank you again for coming to the opening of Me, which is an introspective self-portrait exhibition, as you can see by the work around you. If you're not familiar with Paint Creek Center for the Arts, we are a 501c3 nonprofit art center offering classes downstairs from drawing, painting, photography, ceramic, and a couple mixed media good things. We also have an art market year-round featuring the work of our Michigan artists. Some of them are in the room today or in the exhibition. We host and happily run the Art and Apples Festival, which just ended. So hopefully we saw you guys a couple weekends ago over at the park across the street. We offer exhibitions here in the gallery space, which are free for the public to come and enjoy. And we are moving forward with our new mission as an organization to really focus on Michigan artists. So Me is one of those exhibitions and the first one to start it off. So let's start off introducing yourself, saying where you're from. Since this is a Michigan exhibition, you might have neighbors in the room. So if you want to start.
My name is Italia and I live in Auburn Hills, Michigan.
My name is Rob Kangas, born and grew up in Detroit, now I live in Royal Oak.
I'm Karen Walby, I live in Royal Oak.
My name is Tyler Lentz, I'm from Clawson.
I'm Allie Weadock, and I'm in Rochester Hills.
Wonderful. Can you let the people in the audience know which pieces in the gallery are yours? I know some of you only have one, some have multiple, so if you know where they are.
Well, since it's right there, I have Golden right there with the golden hair. And then on the other side over there, I have Woman on the Beach, okay. And that they're both acrylic.
Okay. Mine's right there. It's the dark one with the red background. Woman's titled Self.
Mine is the one with the red hair on the other side. It's called Sardonyx.
Here you go. Mine, I have three pieces in here. I have the taller one with, it's labeled fire, because it's got fire in it. And then there's two where I'm largely silhouetted, titled Garage and Yard, because they're in my garage and my yard.
I have two pieces to photograph. One is right here behind you called Beatrice, and the other engulfed the other side where I'm like surrounded by Fred Mighty.
So, since these are all self-portraits in some way, shape, or form, some very literal self-portraits, some not so much, we're going to start with some pretty basic questions about your art process. So if we could, whoever wants to start, how and when did you get started making art?
So I've been an exhibiting artist since the 70s. I got interested in photography because my late father had been interested in photography. So I picked up a camera that was in a sock drawer, and it just kind of all spiraled out from there. And so I've been exhibiting every year since I think like 1978.
You're also a photographer, Italian.
Yeah, I originally studied engineering, mechanical engineering, but I have always been interested in photography since I was younger, and I made the career switch around 2009. That's when I started and have been active in photography and filmmaking recently.
You're in the middle.
I've been making art since I could hold a pencil in my hand or a crayon. And I remember being in the back of my parents' car at Bonneville and scraping around on the floor trying to find something to draw with. Or sitting in church for very long hours and drawing and drawing and drawing. So I've been drawing since, and I've been a professional artist since the 90s.
Similarly, I've been drawing, painting, etc. since I can remember, since I was a kid. So my career is mostly based in digital art, but I like to try to stay with classical art with painting and drawings and everything. So yeah, it's a little more of a, as far as painting goes, it's more of a hobby. Whereas the digital aspect is where I do more professional grade work. But.
you know, I've been doing art too since I was a child. I remember the first class I took was in eighth grade. My dad let me take an adult class. He'd come with me. So there he is. And and he did artwork there too. But I got my degree in arts education, and I taught in Clawson for many years, and then I took a leave with my children, and I've been doing art, though, my own art, and doing consignments throughout that entire time. Even no matter how busy it was, I never really stopped because it's just what I have to do.
Very cool. So you guys all have quite a bit of art making experience, some way more than others, sounds like. So that's really cool. Would you guys say that the artwork, since this is a self-portrait exhibition, it's kind of really narrowed as far as the subject matter. Would you say that this is the work that you typically make? Or is this more out there, or is this like a one-off for you guys?
I usually don't do self-portraits. But I had several from the same year, which is almost a decade ago, and those are the ones I submitted. I think it's time to do some more. But I usually do landscape or architecture, stuff like that.
As a photographer who's now living in the selfie age, it's kind of weird to do self-portraiture in the old school way. So, I teach history of photography, and it's normally, when you look at photographers in history, they usually take a photograph of themselves about once every 15 years, and it's to mark, okay, there's a major milestone in my life, or something has changed and stuff like that. And then they never even exhibit it. They actually just kind of leave it in their archives, and then somewhere posthumously, in some kind of posthumous exhibition, then their self-portrait appears or something like that. So now in the era where everybody's doing this every 30 seconds or something like that, this may be actually the first time I've ever exhibited a self-portrait before. Oh, one other time. It just so happened that I was working on one when the gallery call for entries came about, and that's the tall one. And then I had to go all the way back to 2003 for the other ones because of the fact that that was the last time I'd done one previously.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I'm a figure artist, and I always have been. The human face has always been an obsession and fascination for me. So the figure always ends up in my work somewhere. And I do more a collage of imagery and more narrative, more storytelling, more ethereal, maybe a little surreal. So to do just myself was different for me, but it was really great because I could focus in on that. That painting kind of just went along. It kind of told me what to do, and it kind of flowed along as I did it. But I haven't done self-portrait in many years.
Last time I think I did a self-portrait with actual material was probably when I was in high school. Most of the things that I paint with, real paints is more abstract, more about the message, less about what's being visually portrayed. Doing a self-portrait of myself was a little different, and it was a little bit of a different process because when I've painted other people, you're trying to make sure it looks like them and, capturing their essence, so it's a little different when you're trying to capture yourself with a mirror. So it was a little bit of a different process for me, but overall, I liked it.
Well, it isn't what I normally do because over the years I've gotten into landscape, more especially seascapes. I love painting in the ocean. That's just what comes so naturally to me. But same kind of thing that was mentioned when your show came out in the exhibit, I had just completed Golden. And I thought, maybe there's something there I can do. And I think it's an important thing that artists do, to take a step back and look at themselves and be introspective about that. And so even if I wasn't doing as much, I think I'm going to try to continue to do more of that in the future, or more portraits, because it's something, I love the landscapes, but there's having a person in there or having that feeling does change it, and I think that's important.
The art education manager, Shelby, Elizabeth, and I had actually stood up here the other day while talking about the entrance sign outside that talks about, in a paragraph or less, what what the exhibition is about, and we talked about how do you convey the process to make a self-portrait, considering that most artists typically aren't painting themselves or photographing themselves as often. It's just sort of, you know, today I'll turn it around, but typically I'm painting other people or I'm photographing other things or I'm making abstract work. Could you talk a little bit about the process that, you know, the pieces here required of you, since it's, for most of you, it sounds like it's not something that normally you are working on?
Well, I started with the process of photography, of course. So I'm taking a bunch of photos, and then you come down to the one that speaks to you or you think that looks like something you're going to work on, and manipulated it to get to where I wanted to be on, photographically speaking. And then began the process, and still a hand process, which isn't always done that way, but a hand process of transferring all of that. And then I love illustration, and I collect antique and vintage illustration in books. And so that became part of the painting. I didn't know it was going to become a part, and that's the fun part. You like that when something happens. And so I began to lay out a black and white under painting, and I wasn't quite sure if I was going to leave it black and white, and then it just started coming along. And then I had a cover for a vintage book that I was making a piece of art from, and I'm like, that's the background. And so after that, then the leaves began to, from the background, began to come into my hair. I didn't know I was going to do that. But you're trying to come from a psychological standpoint, and you're trying to be pure about it. So you're letting your spirit lead you on this, and it kind of shows you, you know, if there's some sort of flow, and sometimes there isn't. Sometimes you're agonizing over it, and you hate it, and want to throw it out the window. But on a good day, and you leave it, and you paint on it, and then you come back the next day and something else comes, and you paint on it the next day and something else comes. And that's how it went all the way throughout until it was done.
I'm sorry if you say that you're not Italian, just because you've done other exhibitions here, so I'm more familiar with your work. In our photography exhibition back in 2018, you had three very large photo prints of, I think it was like time-lapse photography of flowers throughout night, and then they had had color treatment, and they were like neon glowing. They were super cool. When I look at your portrait that's more abstract, I see the same kind of technique, but engulfed is very traditional photography. Is it more common for you now, since coming away from this traditional photography, to work in that style?
Well, with engulfed, with pictures, I was planning a series for school. Rob was my teacher, of projections and models and that. So I had to take pictures of what I was going to project first. And then I tried the technique on myself. So that's how that one came about. And then I did it with other people. With engulfed, I'm also an environmental activist, and I wanted to show how fragmites are taking over Michigan. And so I just wanted to show how they were engulfing me, kind of. It's like an overwhelming feeling of, you know, this is taking over all these beautiful green spaces. And I never thought about doing them at night or anything like that. Probably it was before I started doing the coloring at night photography, but I do both.
Okay.
Still. Although right now I'm more focused on night, longer exposure photography.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So your photos, two of them at least, have the long exposure technique. I really like in yours that you are not the exact center focus on either of the photographs, and your back is actually turned. Can you talk a little bit about how you set up those shots?
Similar and yet the opposite for Italia here. I started off with that series, and I was interested in a kind of a contradictory idea, which is, was it possible to make a portrait without it having identity? And And so I started using different strategies to try to obscure the identity of people, and yet still it's like, oh, this is a picture of this person who's my friend, this person who's my acquaintance. And at a certain point, I just ran through my friend and acquaintance circle, and I'm like, I got nobody else to photograph right now, but I'd like to make a couple more. So it's like you're always your best, most cooperative model. So in those ones there, I'm actually backlit and facing the camera. But by, you know, understanding lighting ratios, I knew that I would just drop away to being nothing. The one that's in the garage was an early attempt, and at the time I thought it looked just a little too serial killer-ish. And so I said, yeah, that's probably not the one I'm going to go with here. So I ended up in the front of my house, standing in front of my porch lamp, which is the one that I ended up thinking was successful at the time. Recently, I've just been like archiving my work and went back through, you know, some of my earlier work prints and came across the previous one and said, oh, this is, I like this one. It's like, why did I like jettison this one or think that it was not fully successful? The longer ones there, I work with film still, and so I oftentimes intentionally overlap exposures. I always worked in the horizontal panoramic format. And I thought, okay, I'm going to change things up, and I'm going to try to see what happens if I really stretch out the composition vertically. And my wife and I were sitting in the backyard, and I was watching, like, you know, trails of embers going up into the skies. We were sitting around a bonfire in our backyard, and I said, okay, that's a start. Now I got to figure out what I'm going to do with the rest of it.
Yeah, for me, it was pretty much how it was different than how I would traditionally like approach a painting. Since this one actually had like a solid subject, which was myself. So similar to what someone else said, I started with photographs, trying to figure out like how I wanted to photograph myself to, you know, basically transition into the piece. I played around that for a little bit, and my hair was longer at the time, so I had like a little bit of playing around to do with that, but then yeah, just transferred it from a photograph to an illustrate, like a, you know, sketch onto the canvas, and then originally it was going to be all black and white, but I felt like I wanted to incorporate some kind of color in there, so that's kind of where like the background came from. But it was more of how I was feeling at the time, more like that was more of the focus, was like the emotion of what I was feeling, rather than, you know, trying to make it look like a photograph, like look exactly like me, because it's the one thing that like I always think is kind of like, I don't think that always needs to be focused, because I see like paintings that are super lifelike and they look like exactly like a photograph, but at that point you could have just taken the photograph. So
yeah,
I feel like if you can express more emotion in the painting without being so focused and hung up on the detail. So
I had that same sort of response.
So that was kind of how I was approaching this piece.
Well, now, having heard you say that you work more digitally and then you typically do abstract paintings,
so
you can definitely see like those influences in your work.
Yes, I don't know if I just missed it, but I didn't realize that digital was an option for this exhibition. like I said, most of the time when I'm painting, it's not like at a professional level. It's more of just like, you know,
yeah,
kind of like a casual type thing. So, yeah.
For yours, Allie, in look at the top of Allie's piece, Golden, she actually has a little mouth on the very top of it, so all the details wrap around. You could talk about the decision making or the process for going that route.
Sure, and I want to mention my other one on the woman on the beach is a completely opposite, and I like to have that, where I paint a very detailed piece, and then I paint a really fun piece. And that's kind of, so those are perfect for that. So that one was really fun. Honestly, I'm going to be completely honest here. I had some extra gold paint, and I really hate wasting paint. It's one of my things. Like, I have so many extra paint paintings that have like are my favorites. So I had this gold paint, and I'm like, you know, and I'm like, oh, it looks like hair. Well, and then I thought, okay, well, I'm standing right here, and I have a striped shirt on. How can I make this work? And so I pulled it together, and I had, like, you know, I took pictures with my phone, and I'm like, oh yeah, that one works. And then I thought, well, I have to have it go on the top. Like, this has to be fun. So that's my really straightforward, just painting, having fun. And I, in my house where I had it hanging, I had it hanging really low so you can see both angles, you know. And I think both methods are important. The other method for the woman on the beach is completely planned out, drawn out. I did layers of acrylic paint like you would do when glazing, the glazing method like you would use often with oils. The old masters would often try that. And so I did glaze after glaze after glaze and really worked into that one. And so often I'll have one really detailed piece going at a time and then one where I'm having fun. And I can't say, you know, I enjoy them both, but that's what that was for me. And it struck me, and I liked, you know, I do abstracts as well. So I'm always looking at it for the abstract elements, and I loved the abstract of that one.
So you guys have answered all of my questions. Are there any questions from the audience for the artists up here? It can be no, it's totally okay.
I have a question regarding photographic class that you teach.
Yes.
You teach beginners with digital SLR?
Yes.
We have 10 different courses. Beginning digital photography is one of the 10 courses.
We'll talk later.
Okay.
That's it.
Any more questions about signing up for Rob's class?
No.
That's okay.
I have a question for the young man.
Tyler.
Black. You know, I can see your self-portrait from here, and you mentioned that you painted the emotion that you were feeling. Mm-hmm. Would you share with
emotion? Yeah, I mean, it was kind of like a somber place. Things have been kind of like a... So, because I painted it specifically for this exhibition, I saw it online somewhere, and I've never, like, this is the first time I've been, like, in a gallery or exhibition or whatever you want to call it, so, thank you. So I thought it was strictly, like, traditional style, so I got the materials, and it was the first time I'd painted in a while. Like, I hadn't really been feeling like it, and things have been kind of, you know, rough lately, so... So I just thought it'd be something that might kind of distract me, so I just kind of dove into it, and then actually took a little longer than my paintings, like, normally do, because I stopped and started it so often. So I really honestly almost didn't even finish it for the deadline. So it was kind of where, the color choices and everything came from, kind of just, like, a desaturated kind of look.
Yeah, you look like you're, to me anyway, it looks like you're really looking inside yourself and trying to figure out where you are at that point.
Yeah, and I think somebody else said, I think that's kind of what's really cool about, like, painting yourself, is that you're kind of looking past... Yeah, you know, like, at least for me, like, when I paint other people, which isn't often, but I have before, and I'm more focused on making sure it looks like them.
Okay.
Not really capturing, like, them, just, like, their appearance.
Right.
But with
like
me,
like a photograph.
Yeah. So with this one, I was just trying to capture more of
your emotion.
Yeah.
Well, I think you succeeded.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes.
I'd like each artist to name an artist of the past that's influenced their works.
Name an artist that has influenced your work.
I guess I have had some influence from my teacher and mentor, Rob Kangas. He really likes and is very successful with night photography, and I fell in love with night photography and long exposure. That's where I feel the most comfortable and where I can let my imagination fly and create new things. So, that he inspired me.
Wow.
Thank
you.
They're
still alive.
Yeah. the person that's inspired me most just passed away last week. So my favorite photographer probably for most of my adult life has been Robert Frank. And he just passed away last week. He was 94 years old. Went out with his boots on. He was still, you know, working and exhibiting and stuff like that. And he had a certain Detroit connection. He had done a project where he had driven twice across the United States photographing, and both times made a point of going through Detroit because he felt Detroit was very much a very emblematic city of the United States. And he photographed on Belle Isle and the Detroit Rouge plant and stuff like that. And I've just always loved just the grittiness of his work. And so one of the reasons why I continue to work with film is I like this. It's kind of a little bit more of a rougher, raw quality to it.
Symbolic of our Detroit, especially
yeah,
downtown.
Absolutely.
Well, I want to say more than one.
Do it.
So I'll just say maybe five. So, in the beginning, you know, when you're younger, Cassatt was really, you know, I'm looking, who are the women in art? And Cassatt, of course, stood out for me big time. I thought she could hold her own next to date guy any day of the week. And I think that, like, kind of messed with him a little bit. But you couldn't believe a woman could draw so well. And and as she got older, she had a lot of Asian influence and prints that she did that were very simple. And I love that simple line, simple panels of color. And so Cassatt was a big one for me. And she's a, you know, figure artist, of course, and she could do the figure. But I wasn't so interested in her paintings as much as I were these prints that were, she, you know, towards the end, she was doing these very simple, beautiful prints and of figure prints. And but also, I'm very influenced by illustration, the illustrators of today. I'm very fascinated by that. That influences me a lot. Some pop art, and that's four, right? Or is it three? And because we've seen so much of Van Gogh, whether on mugs and even Cassatt, mug, you just, everybody's saturated with that. But I'd be lying if I didn't say I love me some Van Gogh. And I even dreamt I was in a Van Gogh painting once. I did. You know, the boats on the sand, right there. And so I love his use of lime. I have an obsession with lime. In fact, sometimes I have to sit on my hands because I want to draw things with my eyes and I'm drawing them like. And so he used lime heavy when he felt like it, and great panels of color, winning palettes. I mean, you just can't beat his palettes. So, definitely.
So I guess I'm more inspired and everything by just like subjects, not so much like specific artists. If I had to pick one, I guess Picasso. Like, I really like his abstract work. But more so, like, if I see like a painting that I like, it's not so much about the artist, which I know isn't like right to say, but it's more about, for me, what is expressed in each individual painting. So sure, you can like see the style that kind of carries through everybody, you know, all of their paintings, but I think each painting kind of is more about the subject and the, you know, like the content that's actually in the painting and less about like who made it. So, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, I have two I want to mention, and it's, you know, I always have loved Georgie O'Keeffe, and mainly not for her flowers that so many people know. I love her cityscapes, and in fact, I just did a painting of Chicago at night with watercolor, because I'm loving watercolor lately too, and it reminded me of kind of her style, and I've seen a lot of her shows, and I love the simplicity as she did age. She always had this really nice simplicity, but when you would get in person and see the work, it wasn't perfect lines, and I thought, oh my goodness, this is amazing that she can present with this. So I always love her work, but it doesn't really relate to the pieces that I have in here as well. But when I did the Golden, I was thinking about how the lines of portraiture work. And sometimes, I don't want to say cartoonistic, but almost that way. And I looked to Alex Katz a lot. He's still alive in New York City. He has a studio. I think he's in his 90s, but he's still showing work. He really brought that down to where it was the simple forms. And he did do some printmaking as long as that too, but he also did a lot of acrylic. And I looked at a lot of his portraits while I was working in that. Even though it was a quick picture for me, like I said, my process, I still had been like studying in that moment. I went, okay, this is where I can bring this in.
So if there are no more questions for the artists up here, I see many of them have joined us now in attendance. So if we want to grab some refreshments, some snacks, and just mingle and hang out, that would be wonderful. All right, thank you so much.